What we've been taught for decades about normal tissues is that the 3.1 billion base pairs are genetically identical between cells, and that's fundamentally wrong. What we now know is that every cell is unique. Even when a normal cell divides, it introduces about one or more errors per cell division. So the challenge now becomes, how do we study the differences between individual cells, looking at RNA or DNA or epigenomes, and what are the implications of that for biology? So what was one of the biggest surprises you got when you started doing single-cell sequencing?
So one of the big surprises was as we started to sequence copy number profiles in single cells from tumors, we found that there are a few major populations that share similar copy number profiles. And using phylogenetic inference, we inferred a model of punctuated genome evolution. In these short punctuated bursts, you acquired many, many mutations, and then after that burst, the genome was stable for a long period of time. And then in this case, there's another punctuated burst in which you acquire many, many mutations, and then again, the genome is stable for most of the lifetime of the tumor.
So single-cell sequencing has not only helped us identify the time at which these cells take up these mutations, but also which cells have the mutations.
Right, so we can use this intratumor heterogeneity within the tumor as a permanent record so that we can reconstruct the order and the chronology of the mutations or copy number changes that happened over time. So we're going to join Marco now here, who is a graduate student in the lab, and he's going to show us how to do micromanipulation by mouth pipetting to isolate single cells for sequencing analysis. So first, Marco is going to take one of the glass pipettes. He's going to place a plastic tubing that will connect to his mouth so that he can have some input and output pressure. And then he's going to take the glass capillary tube and go to the solution of cells that's on a microscope slide. And he's going to find a single cell and hold it there. And by capillary action, that cell will get sucked into the tube. After that, he'll transfer the glass tube over to a 96-well plate, and he'll blow in to allow the liquid to come out and go into a lysis buffer for the subsequent amplification reactions. So step two will be taking that cell and going into a whole genome or a whole transcriptome amplification reaction so that you can get lots of DNA and RNA that we then use to make sequencing libraries, and we then barcode those libraries, we pull them together, and then we do the next generation sequencing reaction to get data. So this is the data that we get back from a typical sequencing run. And we'll take all of this data, we'll align it to the human genome so that we know exactly where these sequences are coming from in the genome. And then we go through a series of processing steps and filtering steps to remove all the technical errors that might have occurred during the amplification of that single cell.
So the question now becomes, how do you make sense out of that?
So we're going to take our single cell large scale data sets and we're going to upload them to the cluster here at MD Anderson. So now we're leaving the basic science research building and we're going to take a little road trip down to the high performance computing cluster.
So how long does it take for you to, let's say, get data from one cell?
On the cluster, it will only take about 20 to 30 minutes.
Wow.
You can't wait a very long time to get results from patient diagnostic tests or prognostics. So as soon as we get all of the sequencing data back from the sequencing machines, the first thing we do is we take those millions and millions of reads and we upload them to the cluster where we're going to do our initial data processing and analysis.
So typically, how many cells would you analyze at one time?
So it depends on whether we're doing genomes or exomes or we're just looking at targeted gene panels in single cells. For genomes, it would usually just be a few, maybe a dozen at most. Exomes would be a few dozen, and then when we look at panels, we're doing hundreds and hundreds of single cells. So this is a phylogenetic tree that was created from single cell copy number profiles in a triple negative breast cancer. And one branch of the tree, you can see all the normal cells. They have diploid copy number profiles and two copies of each chromosome. Over here, you can see three different tumor populations indicated in blue, in yellow, and in red. What you can see is that there's a very large genetic distance between these subpopulations, which supports a punctuated model of copy number evolution, in which you have these bursts of mutations and you acquire lots of copy number changes, followed by a stable expansion of the population over time.
I can just imagine that there must be lots of other applications where you can actually apply this technology.
Over the last 5 years, we've seen a lot of broad applications of single-cell sequencing in many diverse fields of biology, including things like microbiology and immunology, neurobiology, tissue mosaicism, prenatal genetic diagnosis, which has great clinical applications, embryology to study early development, and things like organogenesis, so the development of organs, and cancer, which is a really big one, where there are many applications both in the cancer research side, but also potential translational applications.
This was an amazing day, wasn't it?
Amazing facility.
Single cells sequencing actually impacts every application you can think of.
Yeah, absolutely. And we finally have a way to measure the very basic unit of life.